dusty face. Oh, tidings of comfort.
Off with you! Go on, you parasites! Away with you! Ah, humbug.
Once upon a time, of all the good days of the year, on Christmas Eve, old Scrooge sat busy in his counting house.
It was cold, bleak, biting weather, and although the city clock was just striking four, it was quite dark already.
It had not been light all day, and dozens of fires flared in the windows of the neighboring offices like ruddy smears upon the palpable gray air.
But Scrooge's window was different. Scrooge had a very small fire.
But his clerk's fire was so very much smaller that it looked like one coal.
Where are you going, Cratchit?
I thought one or two pieces of coal.
You thought one or two pieces of coal, did you? I am not made of money, sir. You would do better to pay less attention to the temperature and more to your work.
Yes, sir.
External heat and cold had little influence on Scrooge, nor warmth could warm, no wintry weather chill him.
No wind that blew was bitterer than he, no pelting rain less open to entreaty. No one ever stopped him on the streets to say with gladsome looks, "My dear Scrooge, how are you? When will you come and visit me?"
No children asked him what it was o'clock. No man or woman ever once in all his life inquired the way to such and such a place as Scrooge.
But what did Scrooge care?
It was the very thing he liked.
To edge his way along the crowded paths of life, warning all human sympathy to keep its distance.
Scrooge was secret and self-contained,
and solitary as an oyster.
This must be distinctly understood, or nothing wonderful can come of the story we are about to relate.
The story of Ebenezer Scrooge's remarkable transformation.
God save you.
God save me from Christmas. It's a lot of humbug.
Christmas a humbug, Uncle? You don't mean that, I am sure.
I do. Merry Christmas. What right of you to be merry? What reason have you to be merry? You're poor enough.
Come then, Uncle. What right have you to be miserable? Humbug. You are rich enough.
Humbug.
Don't be cross, Uncle.
What else can I be when I live in such a world as this? Merry Christmas. Out upon Merry Christmas. What's Christmas time but a time for paying bills without money? Time for finding yourself a year older and not an hour richer. And there's nothing merry in that. If I could work my will, every idiot who goes about with Merry Christmas on his lips should be boiled in his own pudding and buried with a stake of holly through his heart.
Uncle!
Nephew, keep Christmas in your own way. Let me keep it in mine.
Keep it? But you don't keep it.
Let me leave it alone, then. Much good may it do you. Much good it has ever done you.
There are many things from which I might have derived good, by which I have not profited from. I dare say Christmas among the rest. But I have always thought of Christmas time as a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable time. The only time I know of in the long calendar of the year when men and women open their shop-hearts freely and think of people below them as truly fellow passengers to the grave. And therefore, Uncle, though it has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I say that it has done me good and will do me good, and I say God bless it.
Hear, hear, hear.
Let me hear another sound from you, Cratchit. You spend Christmas by losing your position. You're a very powerful speaker, sir. I wonder you don't go into politics.
Don't be angry, Uncle. Come, dine with us tomorrow.
I'll see you in hell first.
But why? Why?
Why did you get married? Married to a penniless girl despite my wishes?
Because I fell in love.
Love. Love. Love is the greatest hypocrisy of all. You mark my words, nephew. You'll work your fingers to the bone to make that woman happy. You'll scrimp and save to try to make her love you. And in the end, you'll find she's resented your efforts on her behalf.
I'm sure you're mistaken, Uncle. Besides, you never visited me before I was married. But why give that as a reason for not coming now?
Good afternoon.
I want nothing from you. I ask nothing of you. Why cannot we be friends?
I said good afternoon!
Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Humbug.
Oh, sir. You've forgotten your Christmas punch.
Don't be silly, Bob. That's for you and your family.
Why, thank you, sir. Merry Christmas.
The same to you, Bob. And Uncle.
What is it?
Happy New Year!
Good afternoon! Pleasure to me to be addressed by either of you. Mr. Marley is dead. He died 7 years ago this very night.
We have no doubt his liberality is well represented by his surviving partner.
Bah.
At this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge, it is more than usually desirable that we provide some slight provisions for the poor and destitute who suffer greatly at this present time. Why, many thousands are in want of common necessities. Food, clothing, shelter.
Are there no prisons?
Plenty of prisons.
And the union workhouses, are they still in operation?
They are still. I wish I could say they were not.
I'm glad to hear it. I was afraid from what you said at first that something had occurred to stop them in their useful purpose.
A few of us are endeavoring to raise a fund to buy the poor some meat and drink and means of warmth. What shall we put you down for?
Nothing.
You wish to be anonymous.
I wish to be left alone. Since you asked me what I wish, that is my answer. I don't make myself merry at Christmas, and I can't afford to make idle people merry.
But Mr. Scrooge...
I am forced, through taxation, to support the institutions you have mentioned, and God knows they cost enough. Those who are badly off must go there.
But many can't go there, and many would rather die.
If they would rather die, they had better do it and decrease the surplus population.
Oh, but sir!
It is not my business. It's enough for any man to understand his own business and not interfere with other people's. But mine occupies me constantly. Good afternoon!
Excuse me, Mr. Scrooge, but it's 6 o'clock, sir.
Correct, Cratchit.
I wondered if I might have my wages, sir.
The trouble with you, Cratchit, is that all you ever think about is pleasure and squandering money. You'll want all day tomorrow, I suppose.
If it's quite convenient, sir.
It is not convenient, sir, and it is not fair. Yet if I was to stop you half a crown for it, you'd think yourself ill-used, I'll be bound. Yet you don't think me ill-used when I pay a day's wages for no work.
It's only once a year, Mr. Scrooge.
Poor excuse for picking a man's pocket every 25th of December. Very well, take the day.
Joy to the world, the Lord is good tonight.
But be here all the earlier next morning.
Clark promised that he would, and wrapping his comforter around his neck several times, for he boasted no waistcoat, ran home to Camden Town as hard as he could pelt.
We wish you a Merry Christmas, kids.
Penny for the baby, sir?
Woman, don't beg on this corner. Scrooge took his usual melancholy dinner in his usual melancholy tavern, and having read all the newspapers and beguiled the rest of the evening with his banker's book, went home to bed.
Merry Christmas, sir.
Be gone from here and take your infernal Merry Christmas with you.
It was dark in Scrooge's house.
But what of that? Darkness is cheap, and Scrooge liked it.
Nobody under the table, nobody under the bed. A little fire in the grate, spoon and basin ready, and a little saucepan of gruel upon the fire.
It was a very low fire indeed.
Nothing on such a bitter night.
Now, what do you want with me?
March.
Who are you?
Ask me who I was.
Who were you then?
In life, I was your partner, Jacob Maury.
Humbug.
You don't believe in me?
I don't.
Why do you doubt your senses?
Because little things affect them. A slight disorder of the stomach upsets them. You might be an undigested bit of beef, a blot of mustard, a crumb of cheese, a fragment of undone potato. There's more gravy than grave about you, whatever you are. Mercy, dreadful spirit, why do you trouble me?
Man of the worldly mind, do you believe in me or not?
I do, I must. Why do spirits walk the earth, and why do you come to me?
It is required of every man that the spirit within him should walk abroad among his fellow man and travel far and wide. And if that spirit goes not forth in life, then it is condemned to do so after death, doomed to wander through the world. Share but might have shared in life and turned to happiness.
You are fettered. Tell me why.
I wear the chain I forged in life. I made it link by link and yard by yard. Is it strange to you? Would you know the weight and length of the strong coil you bear yourself? It was as heavy and as long as this 7 Christmas Eves ago. You have labored on it since. Yours is a ponderous chain.
Jacob? Old Jacob Marley? Tell me more. Speak comfort to me.
I have none to give. Comfort comes from other regions, Scrooge, and is conveyed by other ministers to other kinds of men. Mark me, in life my spirit never roams beyond the narrow limits of our money-changing hall. And now, weary journeys lie before me.
Oh. You were always a good man of business, Jacob.
Business? Yes, part of my business. The common welfare of my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, and benevolence were all my business. The dealings of my trade were but a drop of water in the comprehensive ocean of my business. At this time of the rolling year, I suffer most. Why did I walk through crowds of my fellow beings with my eyes turned down and never raise them to see the misery around me? Never raised a finger to help my fellow man. Behold the agony of a kindness left undone.
Suddenly, the air to the sand was wandering hither and thither in restless haste.
Every one of them wore chains like Marley. None were free.
Many had been personally known to Scrooge in their lives. He had been quite familiar with one spirit who cried out piteously about being unable to assist a wretched woman with an infant.
The misery with them all was, clearly, that they sought to interfere for good in human matters.
And had lost the power forever.
Hear me. Our time is nearly gone. I have come here tonight to warn you that you have yet a chance and hope of escaping my fate. A chance and hope of my procuring, Ebenezer.
You were always a good friend to me, Jacob. Thank you.
You will be haunted by 3 spirits.
Is that the hope and chance you spoke of?
It is.
I think I'd rather not.
Without their visits, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first spirit when the bell tolls 1.
Couldn't I take them all at once and have it over?
Expect the second when the bell tolls 2. And the third when the bell tolls 3. Look to see me no more. And for your own sake, remember what has passed between us. Remember!
Scrooge could not tell.
But they and their spirit voices faded together.
And the night became as it had been when he walked home.
Ah, humbug.
And being from the emotion he had undergone.
Or the fatigues of the day.
Or his glimpses of the invisible world.
Or the lateness of the hour.
Or the dull conversation of the ghost.
Much in need of repose, Scrooge went straight to bed without undressing.
And fell asleep upon the instant.
O'clock and nothing else. A dream, a foolish, childish dream. Coming was foretold me?
I am.
Who or what are you?
I am the ghost of Christmas past.
Long past?
No, your past.
What business brings you here?
Your welfare.
To be awakened by a ghost at 1 o'clock in the morning is hardly conducive to my welfare.
Your reclamation, then. Take heed, rise and walk with me.
But I am mortal and liable to fall.
Bear but a touch of my hand, and you shall be upheld in more than this.
City had entirely vanished. Not a vestige of it was to be seen.
The darkness and mist vanished with it. There was a clear, cold winter's day with snow upon the ground.
Good heavens, I was bred in this place. I was a boy here. My name is John Doe. And Christopher. Christopher, it's me, Ebenezer.
They have no conscience in the bus. These are shadows of things that have been.
Let's play a tag. Not it.
Not it.
Play too.
I'll play with the Ebenezer.
Come on, Christopher, we can't play with him.
Your lip is trembling. And what is that upon your cheek?
Nothing. A pimple. Lead me where you will.
You recollect the way?
I walk it blindfolded.
They walked along the road, Scrooge recognizing every gate and post and tree,
until a little market town appeared in the distance with its bridge,
its church,
and winding river.
They left the hard road by a well-remembered lane and soon approached a schoolhouse of dull brick with a little weathercock on the roof and a bell hanging in it.
The school is not quite deserted. A solitary child, neglected by his friends, is left there still.
The door opened, revealing a long, bare, melancholy room, made plainer still by lines of desks.
At one of these, a lonely boy was reading near a feeble fire.
And Scrooge wept to see his poor, forgotten self, as he had used to be.
I wish. It's too late now.
What is the matter?
Nothing, nothing. There was a group singing a Christmas carol at my door last night. I should have given them something, that's all.
Look, Scrooge.
There!
My dear, dear brother, I have come to bring you home.
Home, little fan?
Yes, home for good now, home forever and ever. Father is so much kinder than he used to be. The home was like heaven. He spoke so gently to me one clear night when I was going to bed that I wasn't afraid to ask him once more if he might come home. He said yes, you should, and sent me to coach to bring you. You're to be a man and never come back here. We're to be together all Christmas long and have the merriest time in the world.
You didn't have a merry time, though, did you, Scrooge?
My father was a very stern man.
He held you a grudge?
My mother died in childbirth, my birth.
Your sister, on the other hand, was always a delicate creature. Whom a breath might have withered, she had a large heart.
So she had, I'll not deny it, God forbid.
She died a woman as well, and had, as I think, children?
One.
True, your nephew Fred.
Yes!
Let us see another Christmas.
Although they had but that moment left the school behind them, they were now in the busy thoroughfares of the city.
It was made plain enough by the dressing of the shops.
But here, too, it was Christmas.
But it was evening, and the streets were lighted up. They passed into a great warehouse, snug and warm and dry. As bright a ballroom as one could wish upon a winter's night.
Good heavens, I know this place. I was a freshman here. Why, that's old Fezziwig. Fezziwig alive again.
Yahoo, my boys! Ebenezer! Dick!
Dick Wilkins, to be sure. Bless me, yes, there he is. He was very much attached to me. My goodness, I am a good-looking chap.
You look rather like your nephew, Fred.
Really? I never noticed.
Yahoo, my boys! No more work tonight. Christmas Eve, Dick. And Christmas, Ebenezer. Let's clear away, my lad. Before you can say Jack Robinson.
Jack Robinson!
Mr. Fezziwig!
This is Fezziwig and her daughters.
What? Where's our bell?
Here I am, Father.
Well, I had forgotten how beautiful she was.
There shall now be happiness and contentment in this room, such as none of us have ever experienced before. Let's have a dance!
Ladies and gentlemen, I have an announcement. Rather, an important question to ask. Belle, this is perhaps the happiest night of my life, and I can think of no better way to mark it than here, in front of your father and mother, our friends and loved ones, to ask you,
go on, go on!
Belle, will you do me the honor of becoming my wife?
Oh, Ebenezer, nothing could make me happier.
And here's the mistletoe!
fezziwig. What a remarkable man.
What's so remarkable? He has spent but a few pounds of your mortal money. 3 or 4, perhaps. Is that so much that he deserves your praise?
Isn't that spirit? He has the power to make us happy or unhappy. His power is in his words and looks, and things so slight it is impossible to count. The pleasure he gives is quite as great as if it had cost a fortune.
What is the matter?
Nothing.
Something, I think.
No. I should like to say a word or two to my clerk just now, that's all.
My time grows short. Quickly.
Again, Scrooge saw himself. He was older now,
a man in the prime of life.
His face had not the harsh and rigid lines of later years,
but it had begun to wear the signs of care and avarice.
There was an eager, greedy, restless motion in the eye, which showed the passion that had taken root.
And when a shadow of a growing tree would fall,
by his side stood a young woman, in whose eyes were tears which sparkled out of the light that shone from Christmas past.
It matters little. To you, very little. Another idol has displaced me. And if it can cheer and comfort you in time to come, as I would have done, I have no cause to grieve.
What idol has displaced you?
A golden one.
I shall never understand this world. There is nothing on which it is so hard as poverty. And there's nothing it professes to condemn with such severity as pursuit of wealth.
You fear the world too much. I have seen your nobler aspirations fall off one by one, until the master passion gain engrosses you.
I am not changed towards you, am I?
Our contract is an old one. It was made when we were both poor and content to be so. When it was made, you were another man.
I was a boy.
Your own feeling tells you that you are not what you were. I am. That which promised us happiness when we were both one of heart is fraught with misery now that we are two. How often and how keenly I have thought of this, I will not say. It is enough that I have thought of it. I can release you, Ebenezer.
Have I ever sought release?
In words? No, never.
In what then?
In a changed nature. In an altered spirit. In everything that made my love of any worth or value in your sight. If this had never been between us, tell me, would you seek me out and try to win me now? Ah, no.
You think not.
Can I believe you would choose a dowerless girl? You who weigh everything by gain? No, Ebenezer. I release you with a full heart for the love of him you once were.
Say something, you fool.
You may for a while have pain in this, but soon you will dismiss the recollection of it as an unprofitable dream. From which it happened well that you awoke. May you be happy in the life you have chosen.
Mel!
Go after her. Go after her, you fool. You fool! Go after her! Spirit! Spirit! Take me back. Show me no more.
I told you. These are the shadows of things that have been. They are what they are. Do not blame me.
I cannot bear it. Take me back. Haunt me no more.
Ebenezer.
stupid old fool! Getting herself all upset over nothing. It was just a bad dream. I'm glad I woke from it.
Suddenly, upon the stroke of two, a blaze of ruddy light streamed forth,
which being only light was more alarming than a dozen ghosts. And Scrooge was powerless to make out what it meant.
At last, he began to see that the source of his ghostly light was the adjoining room. And slowly, cautiously, he opened the door.
It was his own room, there is no doubt about that.
But it had undergone a surprising transformation.
The walls and ceiling were so hung with living green, it looked a perfect robe, from every part of which bright gleaming berries glistened.
Heaped upon the floor,
form a kind of throne.
Poultry, fish, meat,
mince pies, plum puddings, cakes, apples, pears, and oranges.
Upon this throne there stood a jolly giant who bore a torch and held it up
high up
to shed its light on Scrooge.
Ebenezer Scrooge, come in and know me better, man. I am the ghost of Christmas present. Look upon me. You have never seen the like of me before.
Never.
Yet how many of my brothers have you rejected in your miserable lifetime?
I have never met any of your brothers, sir.
You've never looked for them.
How many of them are there?
Over 1,800.
A tremendous family to provide for. Spirit, I have journeyed into the past and learned a lesson which is working now. If you have aught to teach one, let me profit by it. I mean, learn from it.
Touch my robe.
Holly, mistletoe,
red berries,
ivy,
turkey, geese, game, poultry, fish, meat,
pigs, sausages, oysters,
pie, pudding, fruit, and punch.
All vanished instantly. So in the room, the fire, the ruddy glow, the hour of night.
And they stood in the city streets
on Christmas morning.
Poulter shops were still half open.
And the food rows were radiant in their glory.
There were pears and apples cut from high and blooming pyramids.
There were bunches of grapes made to dangle from conspicuous hooks that people's mouths might water as they passed.
The grocers, oh, the grocers.
Nearly closed, with perhaps two shutters down.
Or one.
But through those gaps, such glimpses.
It was not only the blended scents of tea and coffee,
or that the raisins were so plentiful and rare.
The almonds so extremely light.
The sticks of cinnamon so long and straight.
The candied fruits and cakes so spotted with sugar.
How the French plums so flushed in their decorated box.
But the customers were also eager and hurried in the hopeful comment of the day that they tumbled up against each other at the door,
crashing their wicker baskets wildly,
and left their purchases on the counter and came running back to fetch them.
Buying, isn't there?
Oh, Ebenezer, is that all you can see? Come with me, and I'll show you to what good use these wares can be put.
Is there some peculiar power which emanates from your torch?
Oh, yes, there is. Do you know where we are now?
Can't say that I do.
Why should you? You've never been in this part of the city before. This is the lavish home of Mr. Robert Cratchit. Shall we go in?
I don't think I'd be welcome.
As always, we shall be invisible and unheard.
What has ever got your precious father, then? And your brother Tiny Tim? And your sister Martha? Why, she wasn't this late last Christmas.
Here's Mother, Mother.
Merry Christmas, Peter. Belinda, Mother, Merry Christmas.
Oh, I bless your heart alive, my dear. How late you are.
We had a great deal of work to finish, Mother.
Well, never mind, so long as you can. There's Mother coming. Hide behind.
Merry Christmas, my dears.
Mother, Father, wait, 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 wait,
Well, I didn't bring you anything, of course. But if I did, it might be in my left trouser pocket. Okay, okay. Why? Where's our Martha?
Not coming.
Not coming? Not coming upon Christmas Day?
Here I am, Father. Merry Christmas.
Oh, Merry Christmas.
Martha, Peter, you two take Tim and warm him by the fire.
Yes, Mother.
And how did Tim behave in church?
As good as gold and better. Somehow he gets thoughtful sitting by himself so much and thinks the strangest things you've ever heard. He told me coming home today that he hoped the people had saw him in the church because he was a cripple. And it might be pleasant for them to remember upon Christmas Day who made the lame beggars walk and the blind men see.
The goose is ready, Mother.
Yes, I'd best see to it.
Well now, Tim, how are you feeling after sitting by that nice warm fire?
Much better. Mr. Orange, your father, I feel like staying getting stronger. And soon, I'll be able to replace the other children, won't I?
You will, Tim. You will indeed.
Dinner's ready!
It's such a small goose. It's all Bob Cratchit can afford.
Oh, hold it up.
Aren't we forgetting something? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the bounty that you have set before us and for bringing us together on this day of joy and love.
Amen. Amen.
Mr. Scrooge, let us drink to Mr. Scrooge, my dears, the founder of the feast.
The founder of the feast, indeed. Oh, I wish I had him here. I'd give him a piece of my mind to feed upon. And I'd hope you have a good appetite for it.
My dear, the children, Christmas Day.
It should be on Christmas Day which one drinks to the health of such an odious, stingy, hard, unfeeling man as Mr. Scrooge. You know he is, Robert. Nobody knows it better than you, my dear.
My dear, Christmas Day.
I'll drink to his health for your sake. And the day's sake, not his. Long life to him. A Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. He'll be very merry and very happy, I have no doubt.
Mr. Scrooge.
Mr. Scrooge.
Mr. Scrooge.
Now, my dears, no Cratchit Christmas can be complete without our family traditions. We've been to church. We said a blessing on our glorious supper, but there's just one thing we're missing.
A song!
A song!
Tiny Tim, why don't you sing the song they sang at church?
Yes, you!
Come on, Tim.
Tiny Tim lived.
I see a vacant seat at this table and a crutch without an owner carefully preserved. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die.
No, no. Oh, no, kind spirits say he will be spared.
If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, none other of my race will find him here. But what of that? If he be like to die, he had better do it. and decrease the surplus population.
You use my own words against me.
Yes, so that perhaps in the future you will hold your tongue until you learn what the surplus population is and where it is. It may be that in the sight of heaven, you are more worthless and less fit to live than millions like this poor man's child. We still have some time left. Touch my robe.
And now, without a word of warning from the ghost, they stood upon a bleak and deserted moor.
Down in the west, the setting sun left a streak of fiery red,
which glared upon the desolation for an instant.
Like a sullen eye burning lower.
Lower.
Lower yet.
Was lost in the thick gloom of darkest night.
What place is this?
A place where miners live, who labor in the bowels of the earth. But they know me.
An old man.
And an old woman with their children.
And their children's children.
And a generation beyond that.
We're gathered round a glowing fire.
The old woman, in a voice that seldom rose above the howling wind upon the barren waste,
was singing them a Christmas carol.
I saw three ships come sailing in on Christmas Day, on Christmas Day. I saw three ships come sailing in on Christmas Day in the morning. The Virgin Mary and Christ was there on Christmas Day, on Christmas Day. The Virgin Mary and Christ was there on Christmas Day in the morning.
The spirit did not tarry here, but sped.
Where?
Not to see.
To see!
To Scrooge's horror, looking back, they saw the left of the land.
And his ears were deafened by the thundering of water, which rolled and roared and raved.
On! On above the black and heaving sea.
On! On! Until being far away from any shore.
They lighted on a ship. Hoist the mainsail!
Hoist the mainsail!
Hoist the mainsail!
They stood beside the helmsman at the wheel.
The lookout in the bow.
The officers who had the watch. Dark, ghostly figures in their several stations.
But every man among them hummed a Christmas tune.
Or had a Christmas thought.
Or spoke below his breath to his companion of Christmas Day.
With homeward hopes belonging to it.
Smiling by his side.
He couldn't have said that. I'm telling you the truth. He said Christmas was a humbug. As I live, he believed it too.
More shame for him, Fred.
He's a comical old fellow. That's the truth. Not so pleasant as he might be.
True, but his offenses carry their own punishments, and I have nothing to say against him.
He seems the pleasantest of fellows. Why do you hate him so?
My sister died giving birth to him.
I'm sure he's very rich.
My dear!
At least you always tell me so.
Well, what of that, my dear? His wealth is of no use to him. He doesn't do any good with it. He doesn't even make himself comfortable with it.
I don't squander it, if that's what you mean.
I'm sorry, darling, but I haven't any patience with him.
Oh, I have. I am sorry for him. I couldn't be angry with him if I tried. Who suffers by his ill whims? Himself, always. Here he takes it into his head to dislike us. And he won't come a dine with us. Well, what's the consequence?
He doesn't lose much of a dinner.
Oh. Indeed, I think he loses a very good dinner.
I'm glad to hear it. Do go on, Fred. He never finishes what he begins to say. He's such a ridiculous fellow.
I was only going to say that the consequences of him taking a dislike to us is, as I think, that he loses some pleasant moments that could do him no harm. He may rail at Christmas until he dies,
But he can't help thinking better of it if he finds me going there, in good temper, year after year, and saying, Uncle Scrooge, how are you? If he would only give his clerk £50, now that would be something.
£50! They're going to sing.
Now we're all going to sing. Christmas is coming. Do you all know it? Yes, of course. But this year, we're going to sing it around. I'm sure you'll all get very frustrated. Topper, you lead that section, and I'll begin.
Christmas is coming, the goose is getting fat.
I know that song. I sang it as a boy. It was my favorite.
If you had got a penny in the old man's hat, if you hadn't got a penny, then the hasty will drop. If you hadn't got a penny, then God bless you. If you haven't got a penny, then the hasty will do. If you haven't got a penny, then God bless you.
Come, let us visit one more place that I know of.
Oh, no, kind spirit, can't we stay? Look, there's a new game. 1/2 hour, only one.
All right.
Hey, let's play yes or no. All right, I've got one.
Is it vegetable?
No.
Mineral?
No.
Animal?
Yes.
Is it alive?
Yes.
Is it soft?
No, no, not at all.
A porcupine?
No.
Is it a savage beast?
Yes.
Does it growl?
Oh, yes.
Roar?
Yes.
Where does this live?
Yes or no questions only.
Oh. Is it from Africa?
No.
From India?
From India?
No.
From Britain?
Yes.
A wolf.
A boar. A bear. I know what it is.
What?
It's your Uncle Scrooge.
Yes, it is. Friends. My uncle has given us plenty of merriment, to be sure. And it would be ungrateful not to drink himself. Here is a glass of Christmas punch, ready to our hand. To Uncle Scrooge, a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to him. He wouldn't take it from me, but may he have it, nonetheless. Uncle Scrooge!
Uncle Scrooge!
Uncle Scrooge had imperceptibly become so gay and light of heart that he would have pledged the unconscious company in return and thanked them, had the ghost given him time.
But the whole scene passed off in the breath of the last word, and he and the spirit stood once again in the cold, gray streets of London town.
It was a long night,
if there were only a night,
while Scrooge made that alternate
in his outward form.
The ghost grew older, clearly older. Are spirits' lives so short?
My life upon this globe is very brief. It ends tonight.
Tonight?
Tonight at 3. Hark, the time is drawing near.
Spirit, forgive me if I'm not justified in what I ask, but I see something strange there at your feet. Is it a foot or a claw?
It may be a claw, for the flesh there's upon it. Look, look here.
Look, Scrooge! Brought forth 2 children.
Wretched, abject, frightful, hideous, miserable,
where graceful youth should have filled their features out.
A stale and withered hand has pinched and twisted them,
and pulled them into shreds.
Where angels might have sat enthroned, devils lurked and glared out menacing.
Spirit, are they yours?
They are man's, and they cling to me, appealing from their fathers. This boy is ignorance, the girl is want. Beware them both, and all their kind, but most of all, beware this boy. For upon his brow I see the word that's written in his word, which is doom. And let's write to be erased.
Is there no refuge or resource?
Are there no prisons?
Are there no prisons?
Are there no workhouses?
Are there no workhouses? Are there no prisons?
Of the ghost of Christmas yet to come. You are about to show me
shadows of things which have not happened, but will happen in the time before us. Is that so, Spirit? Ghost of the future, I fear you more than any specter I have seen. But as I know your purpose is to do me good, and as I hope to be another man from what I was, I am prepared to bear you company. Will you not speak to me? The night is waning fast, and it is precious time to me. Lead on, Spirit, lead on.
You're scarcely seen, sitting rather seen to spring up around them and encompass them of its own act.
I don't know much about it either way. I only know he's dead.
When did he die?
Last night, I believe.
I thought he'd never die. What has he done with his money?
I haven't heard. Left it to his company, perhaps. He hasn't left it to me, that's all I know. It's likely to be us, if you know. For upon my life, I don't know of anybody who's going to it.
Suppose we volunteer.
I don't mind going, if a lunch is provided. But I must be fed if I waste my time.
Well, I'll offer to go if you will. Come to think of it, I'm not at all sure I wasn't his best friend. For he said hello to me once on the street.
Oh, man.
Scrooge was at first inclined to be surprised that the spirit should attach such importance to conversation so apparently trivial.
But feeling assured that there must be some hidden purpose, he set himself to consider who the dead man might be.
But now the scene had changed, and Scrooge beheld a bare, uncurtained bed. The room was dark, too dark to be beheld with any accuracy.
A pale light rising in the outer air fell straight upon the bed.
And on it, plundered and bereft, unwatched, unwept, uncared for, was the body of a man.
A cat was tearing at the door.
And there was a sound of gnawing rats beneath the hearthstone.
What they wanted in this room of death,
and why they were so restless and disturbed,
Scrooge did not dare to think.
Spirit, I see the case of this unhappy man might be my own. My life tends that way now. In leaving this room, I shall not leave its message. Let us go. I understand, and I would look upon him if I could, but I have not the power. If there is any person in the town who feels emotion connected with this man's death, show that person to me now, Spirit, I beseech you.
They left the chilling scene and went to an obscure part of town.
The ways were foul and narrow, the shops and houses wretched, the people half naked, drunken, slipshod, ugly.
Alleys and archways like so many cesspools disgorged their offenses of smell.
And dirt and life upon the straggling streets.
And the whole quarter reeked with crime, with filth and misery.
Mind to pay for goods I haven't seen?
You'll not ask me how I came by these.
Every person has the right to take care of themselves. He always did.
That's true indeed. Who's the worst of the lot with a few things like these? Not a dead man, I suppose.
If he wanted to keep him after he was dead, why wasn't he more natural in his lifetime? If he had been, he'd have had someone look after him when he was struck with death. Instead of lying there, gasping out his last, alone, by himself.
2 and 10.
Joe!
Not a penny more. I always give too much to the ladies. That's how I ruin my sale.
Now undo my bundle, Joe.
What you call these? Bed sheets?
Bed sheets.
You don't mean you took them out from under them? With them lying there?
Why not?
You were born to make your fortune. These is blankets.
Whose else do you think? He isn't likely to catch cold without them, I dare say.
Hope he didn't die of anything catching.
Don't be afraid of that. I ain't so fond of his company that I'd loiter about him if he died. You may look at that shirt till your eyes ache. You won't find a hole in it. It's the best he had. They'd have wasted it if it hadn't been for me.
What you call wasting of it?
Why, putting it on him to be buried in. It's
Somebody was fool enough to do it, but I took it off again. He can't look uglier than he did in that one.
This is the end of it, you see. He frightened all of us away from him when he was alive to profit us when he was dead.
Spirits, I ask to see emotion connected with this man's death, and you show me only greed and avarice. Let me see some tenderness, some depth of feeling.
The boat conducted him through several streets that were familiar to his feet.
And at last, they entered poor Bob Cratchit's house.
The dwelling he had visited before.
And found the mother and the children seated round the fire.
Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say to you, whoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child shall not enter therein.
The color hurts my eyes. They're better now again. That it makes them weak by candlelight. And I wouldn't show weak eyes to your father when he comes home for all of the world. It must be near his time.
Past it, rather. But I think he walks a bit slower than he used to these last few evenings.
I have known him to walk with Tiny Tim on his shoulder very fast indeed.
And so have I.
Often. That he was so light to carry. And your father loved him so that it was no trouble. No trouble. But here's your father now.
Where is Tiny Tim?
You went today then, Robert?
Yes, my dear. I wish you could have gone. It would have done you good to see how green a place it is. But you'll go there often. I promised them that we would walk there on Sundays. My little child, my little, little child.
Father, please don't grieve so.
Please, Father.
I'm sorry. I have all of you, haven't I? A blessing to be thankful for. You'll never guess who I saw in the street today. Mr. Scrooge's nephew, Fred. He greeted me in his usual, cheerful way. And when he saw that I was a little sad, he asked me what was the matter. And when I told him...
I'm sure that none of us will ever forget Tiny Tim. Will we, children?
Never.
I know. And I know that when we recollect how patient and mild he was, although he was a little, little child, we shall not quarrel easily amongst ourselves and forget Tiny Tim in doing it.
Never, Father.
Never.
I am very happy, my dears. Very happy.
Spirit, I ask to see some tenderness and depth of feeling, and you have shown me that. I need nothing more. Take me back. Wretched man he had seen lying beneath the sheets, lay beneath the ground. Before I draw nearer to that stone at which you point, answer me one question. Are these the shadows of things that may be or will be only? Men's courses will foreshadow certain ends to which they must lead, but if the courses be departed from, the ends will change. Say it is thus with what you show me.
We.
Ebenezer, Scrooge, no, no, no.
spirit, hear me. No, 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 kind spirit. I'm not the man I was. I will not be the man I must have been. Why show me this if I have passed all hope? Good spirit, tell me that I may wash away these shadows. Tell me that I may sponge away the writing on this stone. I will keep Christmas in my heart, and I will keep it all year. I will live in the past. The present and the future. I will not shut out the lessons they teach. I will not shut out the lessons they teach. I will not shut out. Oh, Jacob Marley, heaven and Christmas time be praised for this. I say it on my knees, old Jacob Marley, on my knees. They are here, blankets, my sheets, they are
here.
I am here. The shadows of things that might have been may be dispelled. They will be. I know they will. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Oh, I'm as light as a feather. I'm as happy as an angel. I'm as merry as a schoolboy. Woo! Oh. I'm as giddy as a drunken man. Oh, I don't know what day it is. I don't know how long I've been among the spirits. I don't know anything. I never did know anything, but now I know I don't know anything. Spirits that can do anything they like. Of course they can, of course they can. Oh, hello, my fine young fellow. Do you know the Poulters on the next street at the corner?
I should hope I do.
Oh, an intelligent boy, a delightful boy. Do you know if they sold the prize turkey that was hanging there, the big one?
The one as big as me?
A remarkable boy. It's a pleasure to talk to him. Yes, my bud.
It's hanging there right now.
Is it? Go and buy it. I come back with a butcher in 5 minutes. I'll give you half a crown. What a delightful boy. I think I'm going to like children. I'll take that turkey to Bob Cratchit's. It's twice the size of Tiny Tim. Oh, my dear ladies. No, not my dear ladies. How do you do? I hope you succeeded yesterday. It was very kind of you. Merry Christmas to you both.
Mr. Scrooge?
Yes, that is my name. I'm afraid it may not be very pleasant to you. Allow me to ask your pardon. And will you have the goodness to accept my pledge for...
Lord, bless me, my dear Mr. Scrooge, are you serious?
Please, not a farthing less. A great many back payments are included in it. Please.
I don't know what to say to such generosity.
Don't say anything. Just come and see me.
We will.
Thank you. Much obliged to you. Bless you.
Merry Christmas.
Ah, there you are, my fine fellow.
This is for the turkey.
But, sir.
Take it, take it. And this is for you.
Merry Christmas, sir.
Thank you, Governor.
Oh, my. Oh. Oh, one moment, please.
One moment, please.
Merry Christmas.
Oh, thank you, sir. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. I don't know if you can hear me, old Jacob Marley. And I don't know if I imagined the things I thought I saw. But between the pair of us, we finally made a Merry Christmas.
He went to church
and walked about the streets
and watched the people hurry and to and fro
and patted the children on the head and found that everything could yield him pleasure.
Christmas to you and to your enchanting wife. I was just coming to see you.
Uncle Scrooge?
Fred. I am an old fool who deeply regrets the Christmases gone by that he might have shared with you. I'd like to come have Christmas dinner with you today if you'll have me.
If we'll have you, of course, of course.
Christmas dinner is sharp at 3.
I'll be there.
What are you doing with that turkey?
What turkey? Oh, I'm taking it to Bob Cratchit, sort of a surprise Christmas gift.
But Uncle Ebenezer, you can't carry that all the way to Camden Town. You must have a cab.
Nonsense, I'll sing and dance the whole way.
Uncle Ebenezer, huh? Merry Christmas.
My goodness, isn't that remarkable? You are a lovely couple.
3 o'clock. 3 o'clock.
I'll be there. Deck the halls. Deck the halls with boughs of holly, fa la 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 la.
Tis the season to be jolly, fa la 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 la. Don ye now a gay apparel, fa la 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 la. Toll the ancient yuletide carol, fa la 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 la.
Yes?
Is your father home, my dear?
Yes.
Will you please tell him that Mr. Scrooge is here to see him?
Yes, sir.
This is Mr. Scrooge. Mr. Scrooge, what a surprise.
Mr. Cratchit.
Mr. Scrooge?
Mr. Cratchit, what is the meaning of this?
Mr. Scrooge, I thought we had agreed that I had a day free, sir.
Is that what you thought, sir? Well, let me tell you what, my friend. I'm not going to stand for this sort of thing any longer. And therefore, I am about to double your salary.
Double my salary?
A Merry Christmas, Bob. A merrier Christmas than I have given you in many a year.
He's gone back.
No, I haven't gone mad. And don't worry about your goose, Mrs. Cratchit. You can use it as stuffing for this. We'll sit together, Bob, and discuss what I can do to help your families. To begin with, we'll find the right doctors to get Tiny Tim well. And we will get him well, Bob. We will.
Yes, I believe you. I'll believe anything.
And may this be the merriest Christmas of all our lives.
Scrooge was better than his word.
He did it all and infinitely more.
And to Tiny Tim.
He did not die.
He was a second father.
He became as good a friend.
As good a master.
And as good a man.
As the good old city knew.
Some people laughed to see the alteration in him.
But he let them laugh and little heeded them. For he was wise enough to know that nothing ever happened on this world for good. At which some people did not have their fill of laughter on the outset.
His own heart laughed.
That was quite enough for him.
He had no further dialogue with spirit.
And it was always said of him that he knew how to keep Christmas.
If anyone alive possessed that knowledge.
And may this be said of us. Of all of us.
And so.